I'm here with Dean Offord, and we're going to cover the latest PTZ developments. So, starting with key highlights, what's happened over the last year then?
It's been a really good year for Panasonic PTZ. We've had some amazing case studies come out. As you know, we have a very, very expansive range. So from our small PTZ, so entry level, mid level, up to specialized level, every user is adopting PTZ in different ways. And some of the key highlights that we had in terms of case studies, innovations in auto tracking. We had 63 UE70s being used in Cisco Live.
How are they using them?
So they had multiple conference rooms and they had different seminars happening, and the trouble is with PTZ as well, sometimes you just don't have enough operators. So to have a centralized platform where you can run the software and start tracking multiple cameras at the same time saves a lot of time on installation cost and also resources of trying to locate those operators. So they really benefited from having that centralized automated system. I really feel that as we're heading more into the future and we're showing from Panasonic different live automation systems, this is going to be the way, and PTZ are at the forefront of doing that. Another really good highlight is the success of the UE150. We've had a really strong launch. Lots of rental companies are adopting them. It's 4K 60p. Even now today we have Vlog implemented into it, so it's being used in production purposes. And from the rental companies that we're speaking to, they're out the door all the time, so it's really good to hear. But we're seeing them in all sorts of places, even the UEFA Champions League when they're walking down, going into the pitch.
For tunnel cam, wasn't it?
Tunnel cam, yeah. So it's really nice, discreet, great quality.
And what about the Gothenburg Symphony installation? How was that?
Gothenburg was really great. So it was starting to combine the UE150s in a theatre setting, and also using the Panapod. So the Panapod system is being able to elevate them.
Yeah.
Another thing about PTZs is when you have them fixed in an installation, it's creating that dynamic movements. And you can really, really change up your shots of PTZs. You're very limited in one fixed position, but having one operator being able to remotely control them, now with the Panapod innovations of having them being controlled over IP, again, that centralized system, we're really at the forefront of doing it.
Nice. So this year marks the 10-year anniversary since the first PTZ from Panasonic was the HG100.
Yeah.
So what would you consider to be the most groundbreaking innovation, I suppose, that you've seen this year?
Yeah, so it's been really amazing since then, you know, over the decade pretty much for PTZs.
Yeah.
The HG100 was some cases still being used, which is amazing. It's a testament to the ergonomics of the product. For me, I think the UE150 naturally has just been amazing. It's the first PTZ with 12G out the back, fiber support, simultaneous output, which is amazing. But also NDI innovations. So NDI HX in our products, I think as a manufacturer in our PTZ lineup, we have the most amount of PTZs probably supporting NDI HX because it's really accessible.
So what do you see as being the key benefit of NDI then?
NDI single cable workflow.
Yeah.
So in terms of networking, it's been a lot easier just to install with a single cable. I feel like anyone can do it. Even your router at home, you can stick in some cables. And with a POV Plus switch, our controllers are all powered by POV Plus. The cameras are powered by POV Plus. Saving money on adapters, resources, so it's more green.
Set up times.
Environmentally
well.
Friendly. So it's really, really powerful. Also things like the HR140, to me, is one of the best engineered products that we've also done. Outdoor integrated enclosures with wipers, IP65. Exactly. So being able to do that, and we've heard from, you know, whether it's a broadcaster or a rental company, having that ability just to plug and play is really, really beneficial. So it's some amazing innovations coming out the factory.
Great. So let's go on to sort of product launches then. So let's start with the HG42. Can you tell us a bit about that?
Yeah, HG42 has been doing really well. It's for those customers that have been, maybe they've used the HG40, the HG38,
right,
which are more kind of an entry level size, but now they're looking to go up into the HD production workflow, but you know, at the right price as well.
Of course, yeah.
HD production, as we know, is still very much being used in everyday scenarios and multiple applications. And the HG42 introduced the 3G SDI, so, and also Genlock, so multiple camera shows and rigs. It's great that we can do that. We also have fast switching firmware, which we're showing here in the RP150. So you've got multiple cameras. It's a nice combination with something like the HG42 or the UE150 to quickly select. So if people are really looking to step up in their production, the HG42 would be perfect for that.
Cool. And then we've got the UE4, which is the first time we've shown it at a show here at IBC. tell us a bit about that. Where's it? Obviously, the HQ2 was incredibly popular because it came as a small camera at a really nice price point. So, yeah, tell us a bit about the feature set of that.
Yeah, the HQ2, when it was discontinued, was an uproar in the market about what's the replacement going to be. So we took a long time listening to customers. We visited lots of different education corporates and studios, as they're used in radio. Visual radio television applications.
Yeah.
And the UV4 has been designed now with 4K, pan and scan capability, 4x magnification into the sensor.
And the field of view is greatly improved as well.
Yeah, 111 degrees, which is a big step up from its 95 as well previously. So we're seeing a lot more PoE as well. Before, the HQ2 couldn't do that. Still has microphones embedded in there. For stereo capture of the audio, and it can fit into multiple applications. So whether you are, again, education, corporate, but you're looking for really nice wide-angle views of studios where it's quite difficult to put them in, you place it in the corner and capture the content in really nice 4K 30p. It's amazing.
Cool. And then finally, we've got the RP60, which is the first time it's been going. Can you tell us a bit about that?
Yeah, the RP60, so the RP50, everyone again was crying out, when's the next version going to be coming out of that?
Yeah.
Listening to market feedback, much better joystick, more user buttons. We have a color display with more information on it. As you know, the RP50, we had only two lines of information, but now we can really see what we want to map. So whether you want to see your ND filters or your shutter speed or how you can quickly coordinate it as an operator. We listened to those concerns and we've done that. And also made it PoE Plus. So you don't have to have your AC adapter if you forgot it. If you've already got your PoE Plus network switch, just plug it in like your cameras and away you go. And that runs 100 meters. So installation is really, really easy.
And what about the camera grouping functionality? Can you tell us a bit about that as well?
Yeah, the camera grouping is great because before it was a little bit fiddly with the pages. So, you know, having to navigate between page one and two with your five banks of cameras. Now it's just on a dial. So you can just quickly jump between your different banks of cameras, so it makes it a lot easier and a lot more accessible for those guys that are using them in more professional situations in broadcast.
Brilliant. Look, thanks so much for your time, Dean. Remember, if you've got any questions, please do feel free to write them on the comments, and we'll see you soon.